Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome into the LakersNation.com podcast. I am Trevor Lane, and joining me today, we've got some optimism in the house. Matt the Optimist Peralta. Matt, how are you doing?
Trevor, I'm doing so good. It's the first day of spring. The Lakers just won a game. I'm feeling warmed up for whatever reason. So you know what? Everything's great.
Peek behind the curtain here. This is the second time we're recording this show. The first time was lost in tragic fashion. It will be the unaired episode of the LakersNation.com podcast, Lost to the Ages, such unfortunately. But that means we can just perfect all the things that we're going to say now that we get to say them twice. Gotta love technology. No, honestly, it was user error. It was my fault. But let's start here. You know, Matt, feels weird doing this analogy twice, but I'm going to go with your... We're going to do something that is right in your wheelhouse here.
Okay.
I'm going to ask you this question.
Okay.
So how much do you trust this Lakers team? So let's say, I mean, coming off this big win against the Atlanta Hawks, they won by over 30, but they've also had some gut punch losses. If you were to set a date, you're going to meet the Lakers at a restaurant for dinner. Mm-hmm. You get to the restaurant, you sit down. How confident are you that the Lakers are showing up?
Yeah, look, I think that it is... To be fair, it would be like a 50-50. So I guess 5 out of 10, 6 out of 10. And it's because you just don't know what version of this team you're going to get on a nightly basis. You'll get nights where they blow out teams like the Hawks, and then you'll get nights where they've got pivotal playoff matchups or, you know, games against teams that they're competing directly for in the standings, and they lay an egg. So if I'm on this date with the Lakers, I'm crossing my fingers and hoping that they show up because I want to like them. There are positive things about them I've seen. But if they stood me up, I would totally get it. And I would say they have issues that they need to fix in the offseason. So that's where I'm at.
They have issues. That's, I think, been the challenge for Lakers fans so far this season, is that even coming off of that win against the Hawks, which, look, would much rather win than lose. But there were a lot of Lakers fans who said, oh, but it's just the Hawks. Oh, but they did this. We've hit that point where we've had such a Jekyll and Hyde season that a lot of people, they've been burned so many times that even in that moment when the team does show up, it can still lead to that, well, but I know I'm going to get hurt again down the road. And so that's the dynamic right now we see with Lakers fans. And I say all of this to get us into a discussion about playoff mode, because that's what needs to stop happening. This Jekyll and Hyde stuff that we've been seeing all season, frankly, has to fall by the wayside right now. I mean, it had to fall by the wayside weeks ago. Didn't happen. 13 games left. And now, LeBron James. Anthony Davis said this after the win against the Hawks. Said, Bron is Bron. Obviously, it's that time of the year. Shooting the ball extremely well. He's in attack mode finding guys. He's been locked in defensively. So it's that time of year, especially for us, where every game is a playoff game. So the time of the year, extensively lock in and get the job done. In other words, LeBron is activating playoff mode, right? Is what Anthony Davis is talking about. Will that be enough to get rid of this roller coaster effect? And are we finally going to see the Lakers really kick it into gear with at least moderate consistency? There's still going to be bumps in the road, but are we going to see this team start to perform on a more consistent basis from here on out, because they're going to get a more locked in LeBron James who is more willing to burn through some of his gas tank at this stage of the year?
I mean, look, I think you're certainly hoping so. We have talked a lot about the Lakers teams and how they kind of follow LeBron's lead. And if we're going to get fully engaged LeBron on both sides of the floor, then that would lead to the idea that, you know, the Lakers by, you know, association would be better. And so, yeah, I'm definitely hoping so. And I think that LeBron's been looking good almost the entire season, really. I feel like, you know, given he's been healthy for most of it, he's looked like LeBron James. Like, yeah, maybe he's lost a step half a step athletically, but he is still the top tier of athletes in the league. So as long as he's healthy, I think the Lakers have got a shot. I think that the team will be better off for it in a lot of obvious ways. And so, again, just fingers crossed, because I don't think either of us would like the season to end earlier than it's looking like right now.
No, certainly not. Would like to see the team make a real run here. Still believe this is a talented group. And obviously they've got to have some guys get healthy. And we'll talk more about that in a moment. But, you know, one of the things that that we talked a lot about over the summer was the way this roster was constructed. And I think this is actually giving me a little bit of cause for concern. The way this team was put together, when we look at the roster construction, they really went all out to add wing depth. And that wing depth, in theory, should allow this team to not have LeBron burn through as much of his gas tank during the regular season, just getting to the postseason. It should have allowed him to coast a little bit more, but the Lakers have been one of the most injured teams in the NBA. LeBron and Anthony Davis have mostly been healthy. So what that means is that most outsiders around the NBA don't look at the Lakers and think they've suffered very many injuries because the two main stars have been relatively healthy, especially by their standards, but everybody else has been hurt. So, like right now, Jarred Vanderbilt, right? He's been out. Cam Reddish, he's out. These wings that were going to take some of the burden off of LeBron haven't really been around to do that. And so I'm a little concerned that LeBron has had to bear, once again, a good chunk of the burden during the regular season. And now we're hitting this final stretch here, and he's going to wind up just to get the Lakers into the postseason, burning through whatever he's got left in the tank. And then we're going to have kind of a LeBron who's out of gas come playoff time. And that may just be the reality, just the unfortunate truth of the season. But LeBron kicking it into gear now, I really wonder, given how taxing the season has been, how long can he keep that level of production up? Because we still have 13 games left, and then however long they play in the postseason.
Yeah, I think it's a valid concern, especially when you're talking about a 39-year-old with, you know, just a godly amount of number of miles on his body at this point in his career. So I think the Lakers do have to be mindful of that. They're always mindful of it, no matter where, at any point of the season. But I think especially this stretch of it, with the play-in tournament and hopefully playoffs around the corner. But I think, you know, we saw the first hints of it when LeBron, I guess, in the Clipper game, right? He decided to guard Kawhi in the second half, and that's what basically changed the game, right? I don't think LeBron does that at that point of the season, unless he knows, like, okay, this is the mode I'm going to have to be in for the rest of the year for the Lakers to kind of get to where we need to be. So I trust that he understands how much energy he's exerting right now, and that he's kind of already like mapped it out in his head. Like, okay, starting from game X in the regular season, I can, you know, go at this percentage and then still be okay for, you know, a potential playoff run. Like, LeBron's been there, done that at this point of his career, like 21 seasons. Like, I think he understands like how to pace himself. And so I'm going to trust he knows what he's doing. And that's maybe the optimistic, you know, the optimist in me talking, but I just don't think he would burn himself out, you know, this early on if he didn't think he could like at least like perform to the way he wants to in the playoffs.
Yeah. If anybody can pick their spots, it's LeBron. It's LeBron. I mean, he understands that better than anybody else. But in terms of help for LeBron in this playoff push, one of the guys that we have to talk about here, it's D'Angelo Russell, who has been great for the Lakers this season and is now about to pass the great Nick the Quick Van Exel in terms of Lakers three-pointers made in a single season. So D'Lo, probably Friday, is the all he has to do. He's tied the record. All he has to do is hit one. Mm-hmm. 1-3 on Friday against the 76ers for D'Lo will set the new record. What are your thoughts on him? And do we trust D'Angelo Russell to be a key piece into the postseason, especially given what happened last summer, last postseason, and how everybody has been saying since then, or especially the D'Lo haters have been saying since then, he has to prove it in the playoffs. How much faith do you have in D'Angelo Russell?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, I think it'll be cool for him to presumably break the record on Friday. He's had a great season. I mean, really the great second half of the season, but he's been awesome. General thoughts, though, like I think D'Lo is by far and away the Lakers' third best player as things stand. I don't think that's even a question at this point. He's just playing so well offensively that it's hard to ignore. And I think it's a combination of, one, he's playing really well. He has a lot of confidence. He's shooting the ball, which is the most important thing. So I just feel like by merit, he deserves to be in the rotation and starting in the postseason if the Lakers get there. But then second thing is, it's also, what are your alternatives to D'Angelo Russell? You'll get, still working his way back, Gabe Vincent, maybe. You'll have Spencer Dinwiddie, who's been kind of hit or miss offensively since he signed with the Lakers. So I just feel like D'Angelo's locked in. He just can't come off the floor, especially in important games for the Lakers going forward.
Now, Darvin Ham had some really positive things to say about D'Angelo Russell, which, coming on the heels of that ESPN article from about a week ago, yeah, D'Lo didn't exactly present Darvin Ham in the best light. Did sound like maybe they're on better footing now, but it, and he didn't say kind things about Dennis Schroeder either. But here's what Darvin Ham said about D'Lo after the game against the Hawks, a game in which D'Lo went on a one-man blitz at the end of the third quarter, hit a couple of big threes, one of them from the logo. I mean, he was fantastic. Here's what Darvin Ham said. He has a green room, not a green light, a green room. And then he went on to explain why and explain D'Lo's gravity makes it so important that he continues shooting and continue to be aggressive. Apparently, I haven't heard this before, Matt, a green room. I'm assuming that's better than a green light, apparently. I don't know how the green hierarchy stacks up. Like, where does a green thumb fit into all of that? I don't know. Mm-hmm. But it sounds like a green room means that Darvin Ham really wants D'Angelo Russell shooting the basketball. And then D'Lo responded to this when he was informed of Ham's comments by saying he appreciated the trust that Ham has in him. So is everything great? It's all sunshine and roses now, but between D'Angelo Russell and Darvin Ham, and it's all good, and D'Lo's going to be taking all these shots and everything? Or is it Lakers are going to draw Denver, and it's crunch time in fourth quarter, and there he is, you know, sitting on the bench again because Darvin decided to put in Cam Reddish like we saw a month ago? Is that, how do you see this playing out from here?
Yeah, I mean, well, first of all, maybe it is sunshine and roses because it is springtime, Trevor.
Oh, so the seasonal connection. I like it.
That's why I'm a professional. Second, as far as like the green light, green room thing, you know, I think you and I were probably thinking street light, but maybe Darvin Ham was talking like, you know, like nightstand light, and now he's got the whole room.
Okay.
I'm trying to rationalize. I've
never heard it before. I mean, I've heard of a green room.
Yeah.
But like the green, like when we're talking about, it's kind of the staging, especially we hear about it like NBA draft and everything. Yeah. But anyway, it's a good thing.
It's a good thing. Yeah. Okay. So back to the comments thing though, seriously, I feel like it's just one of those things are going well. So what, like if it's not broke, don't fix it kind of deal. Like, look, he's playing well. He's doing what I'm asking. I think we're good. Like I just kind of think D'Angelo is one of those people that will say whatever's on his mind at any given moment. Like it's almost like a stream of consciousness kind of thing with him. Like you'll ask him something and like he'll literally tell you like what he's thinking like internally. Like some people will like have that thought, but then they'll phrase it differently. I think D'Angelo is very much like, yeah, this is just exactly what I'm thinking. I'm going to tell you. So I think that to me helps explains the ESPN article last week. And then this week, or I guess the other day, really is more so like, yeah, like, look, this is how things are right now. So this is what I'm going to say. And like, maybe it's a little bit of walking back his previous comments to kind of, you know, ease how that was originally perceived by the fan base. But I also do think that right now, like, whatever they're doing is working. And so until that changes, I imagine that D'Angelo is going to be a fixture in the starting lineup because, again, like, he's played like no one else on the roster has his upside offensively.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, aside from, you know, of course, LeBron, you can even argue he's got more offensive upside than AD. I think you could make that argument right now, but yeah, that's not a knock on AD. That's more a statement of how great D'Angelo Russell has been for the most part. Now, I think, and this is, I don't know if Darvin Ham will share this opinion, but I believe D'Angelo Russell is now beyond benching. He's too important to the team. He is, in my mind, matchup proof. In that, it doesn't mean that every single matchup is a good one for him. he's hit the point where it doesn't matter what the matchup is. Even if it's a bad matchup for him, he's too important to your team. You have to keep him on the floor and you figure out other pieces to move. You can't do what you did against Denver a month ago where you sit D'Lo in favor of playing Cam Reddish. Matchup wise, is Cam Reddish a guy who could play defense and rebound a little bit? Is that what the team needed at the moment? Maybe, but the difference, the gap between D'Angelo Russell in terms of quality of player and a Cam Reddish whose skill set might be a little bit better of a fit, it's just too big. You can't pull him off the floor. He's got to have that trust that Darvin is talking about, not just in terms of having a green light, a green room, whatever you want to call it. He has to have that trust in the big games, in the big moments, even when the situation on the floor isn't ideal for D'Angelo Russell. He's got to stay in the game. He's got to stay out there because, frankly, the Lakers aren't winning without them, especially, you know, Matt, we look at what the Lakers have become in terms of a very offensive-based team. They are now third in the NBA in offensive rating since the All-Star break. They're second in the NBA in three-point percentage since the All-Star break. Those are D'Angelo Russell heavy stats, right? He's a big part of those. That's how they're winning. It's right now by when they do win, it's by their offense being so good. D'Angelo Russell can't come out. I don't care what the matchup is. If it's D'Lo's getting torched by Jamal Murray, he's got to be on the floor. And I think that's what we're going to have to see throughout the rest of the season and into the postseason. That trust that Darvin Ham has to put him to call it the green room or whatever, that needs to extend to crunch time situations from here on out.
Yeah, look, I think, by the way, I agree with you. I think this is a really good way to illustrate it, right? Is assume the Lakers win their play-in tournament game or games, right? They almost undoubtedly go into every series as like the quote-unquote underdog. Mm-hmm. And I think when you're the underdog, and for avid fantasy football players like you and me, you know that if you are projected to not win your matchup, you need to introduce some volatility into your lineup. Because if you have a guy that can explode randomly that one week, you strike gold. Mm-hmm. And look, maybe they strike purple and gold in this case. Oh man, I'm on a roll. I'm super good when I'm warmed up. We should do double recordings on podcasts more often.
Let's
No. No. But anyway, my point being is like, look, D'Angelo is that volatility that the Lakers need. They need a guy that, besides LeBron and AD, that can get their own shot and turn a game on its head offensively. And that's D'Angelo Russell. And I think that's a role he excels in. I think he relishes it. You see him when he hits another, like his third three in a row, like on a ridiculous off the bounce, like half court heave, whatever. Right. He's always hamming up the crowd and making sure people are excited. And I think that's his role. I think he's found it. I think he enjoys it. And I think that Darvin would be beyond foolish to bench him at any point now, because he's just too important for your offense. Like, you're outscoring teams and you're not playing defense, but like, that's the formula to win games right now. You have to leave D'Angelo in.
Is D'Lo a Laker long-term here? Do you see him sticking around?
I am interested in what his next deal looks like. And
yeah,
because like, he's definitely earned more than what he's going to make on his player option. That's for sure. So
I wonder if any, in any way, his decision is linked to any decision around Darvin Ham's future.
That's not a bad, I mean, depending on how the Lakers finish the season, like, we're going to be having a lot of Darvin conversation. We already are.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah. But imagine how many conversations we'll have if he, like, they just flame out completely.
Oh God.
Yeah. It'll be bad.
He won't like, yeah, that would not be at that point. Look, I think, and this is, you know, not to get into a Darvin tangent, but I think we're already at the point where, unless they go do something totally unexpected, like win a championship this season or something like that, the conversation has to be had in the front office about the head coaching spot. Like a serious conversation about, do we need to move on here? Do we need to look elsewhere? And if it were up to me, yes, I'm moving on. I'm looking elsewhere at this point. And I've gone into detail on why on a lot of shows. But I think that's a conversation that's going to need to be had. And I would have to imagine that D'Angelo Russell's future, and to a greater extent, LeBron's future, will be a big factor in determining what the Lakers do or don't do at the coaching position.
Yes, this is a can of worms that we probably shouldn't open right now, but I'm in full agreement. I think there will be a lot of conversations about this. And yeah, I never like to say coaches are you know, working for their job right now, or they're coaching for their job, but that's definitely what's happening right now.
I'll say this, Matt, if they do decide to move on from Darvin Ham, please don't do it like 30 seconds after the conclusion of the final game of the season. Please don't, let's not do that this time. I think that's a low bar there.
Yeah, I think we can do it.
God, I felt so bad for Frank Vogel. That was awful.
Man, poor guy. Yeah.
That was awful. All right. You know, this Lakers team, they need to get healthy. We talked about the offense and how great the offense has been. Part of that is because all of their defensive players have been hurt. Cam Reddish is out. The biggest one, of course, Jarred Vanderbilt is out. Christian Wood, who helps you on the boards, he's out. Gabe Vincent has been out. But now we're getting conflicting injury reports here, Matt. Kind of bizarre. We saw this yesterday. Bill Reiter from CBS announcing that, surprise, Christian Wood, who, by the way, Woj announced during the Hawks game that he's going to be undergoing arthroscopic surgery, and Christian Wood is now going to miss a number of weeks. That could mean the end of his regular season, maybe the end of his season period. But we had Bill Reiter say that Christian Wood, Jarred Vanderbilt, Gabe Vincent, they're all done for the season. They're not coming back. And then like 6 hours later, Mark Stein chimes in and says, oh, no. Sources told him that Gabe Vincent is coming back, barring some unforeseen setback. He's planning to come back this season for the Lakers. This fits more in line with what Shams Charania said a week ago. This fits more in line with what the Lakers themselves have been joking. Our own editor extraordinaire, Daniel Starkan, got footage of Gabe Vincent at Lakers practice. Doesn't look like a guy that's not planning on coming back, but it was a bizarre situation. The Lakers definitely need these guys back out on the floor. And now we're getting conflicting reports of whether or not they're going to come back. Matt, this is just the media madness sometimes that we see in this sports world of ours.
Yes. If I was back in journalism school right now, there are plenty of examples that I could look at for things not to do when reporting, you know, verify your sources, you know, confirm your reports before actually reporting it to, you know, tens of thousands of people that are very interested in the subject. Also, the other thing too is like, if you are following a team, you know who covers a team regularly on the beat. And those are typically the people that are their most trusted sources. You know, you brought up our editor extraordinaire, Daniel Starkan. That's an example of where you can get your news and rumors and accurate information. And as someone that has been writing for LakersNation.com, all the injury updates, it did not make sense to me when I saw that report come out, because Darvin Ham literally just a couple of days ago said Gabe Vincent's last thing is just reconditioning. And he also hasn't ruled out Vanderbilt because he's also said he's on schedule. And I think we can probably assume on schedule means return at some point before the regular season ends. So yeah, it was weird. I'm glad that it got clarified quickly afterwards, but also again, if you've been following the team, you know, regularly this season, I think you'll know like whether or not these guys are going to be out for the rest of the season or not. It's been monitored super closely. It was confusing at first, but I'm just glad that I think everyone's on the right page now.
Yeah, I think it's still possible that Jarred Vanderbilt we don't see. I mean,
sure.
Vando's been posting a lot of workout footage lately. He doesn't look like a guy who is interested in any way of just, okay, I'm going to get healthy for the summer. Like, he looks like, you know, the workouts you're seeing him do, he's clearly working towards something, right? But he's also mostly posting footage of himself riding the bike. He's doing like band activities and things like that. It's not like he's posting footage of himself out there dunking. Now, there has been some stuff of him like shooting layups and things like that, but it's not the super explosive stuff. So again, there's only a few weeks left right now. Stubbing your toe could be a season ender because there's just not that much time left in the season. But I do think that Vando, if I had to place a bet on it, I would say he probably is going to come back this season. I think Gabe Vincent is definitely coming back. I mean, that seems pretty clear right now. Christian Wood, I don't know. I don't know if he makes it back in the regular season, but I certainly can't look at all three guys and just say, oh no, they're done for the season. So it was good to see the pushback on that, especially it just made no sense. And yet a lot of Lakers fans got upset in the moment that, oh my gosh, all these guys are out. I don't think we can come to that conclusion right now, especially when we're getting footage of these guys. They're doing stuff, clearly doing everything they can to get back out on the floor. And in particular, Gabe Vincent seems like he may even be days away and not weeks away at this point.
Yeah, I'm in agreement. I think that I'm 90% confident Gabe Vincent makes an appearance before the end of the regular season. Vando, not as much, but I'm still leaning on that he does come back at some point. So fingers crossed that those guys are back soon.
And if I had to rank it, unfortunately, I think my ranking in terms of importance, it's Jarred Vanderbilt. There's a big gap. Christian Wood. There's a gap. And then it's Gabe Vincent.
Oh, yeah.
And look, they spent the MLE on Gabe Vincent, or most of it on Gabe Vincent. So there's that financial incentive to bring him back out on the floor. But they already replaced him. They brought in Spencer Dinwiddie. In terms of what the team needs right now, unfortunately, the guy who I think is closest to returning is the guy that's at the bottom of the list in terms. And I think Cam Reddish is back like literally any day. Darvin Ham even mentioned that. But the guy that is the closest to returning in terms of Vincent, Vando, Christian Wood is, I think, the guy that they actually need the least out of that group. I'm not going to be upset that he comes back. That's great. More, all hands on deck. Let's go. But it's really Jarred Vanderbilt. Like that Vanderbilt is really the guy that you're waiting to see come back.
Yeah, that one hurt. Like, well, literally for him, but you know, for the rest of us, yeah, like he was rounding into form too, which was like the worst part about the timing of the injury, because you remember he started the season, you know, on sideline, came back, did not look like himself for a little bit, and then started to look like Mando, and then he gets hurt. It was cruel. So yeah, I'm hoping he is able to come back, because I think Vando at any percentage is just, he's integral to this team.
Well, and this is a group that has been great offensively. Their defense has been awful.
Yep.
Awful. And that's the area of the floor that he can impact the most. They're rebounding as well. And that in part is where they miss Christian Wood. All right, Matt, let's get into the mailbag a little bit here before we close out our second go round on this show. AW became a new channel member. Guys, you can click the link over on the YouTube channel. There's a link in the description down below, as well as the join button. And you can see the perks that we offer. We do a members only weekly show where channel members get to actually come on the show with us, hang out, all that. It's a lot of fun. So you can check out the channel membership program, AW becoming a member. Andrew said, it appears that AD's hip flexor slash ab issue is healed. Yeah, it's been a little bit. Like, AD has popped up on the injury report for a few things, most recently the eye. Mm-hmm. But this hip flexor situation, whatever it was that he was dealing with for a while there, that it's either healed or it's healed enough to where it doesn't seem to be an issue anymore.
Yeah, I would lean the latter. I kind of feel like it has been a little odd that they haven't really brought it up again, but I think that kind of just speaks to the nature of the injury. It sounds like something mm-hmm. that was really bothering him, and then it kind of just subsided over time and with some rehab and recovery. So at this point of the regular season, though, we understand that not every player is 100% healthy. And so Anthony Davis definitely falls in that category for me. I think that it probably does still, you know, hurt to some extent, but it's just not worth reporting on an injury report. So yeah, I mean, he's playing. They haven't talked about it. So we just kind of have to treat it as if it's a non-issue right now.
Yeah, and that does seem to be where it is, which is great news. Miguel said, if you're the Lakers, would you cut Wood and continue to pay for his medical expenses similar to Boogie and sign a playoff eligible big? Cutting Christian Wood would lock into next season's cap a dead money hit of about $3 million because he does have that player option. So I don't think the Lakers, so right there, Matt, I don't think the Lakers are going to do that. And we could talk about, should they go sign Dwight or whatever, Dwight Howard, he put out that post on Instagram the other day where, like, he's very clearly, I joked it was like a mixtape for the Lakers. It was like all their greatest hits. It was showing Dwight winning a championship with the Lakers and all that, and talking about how much it meant to him and all that kind of stuff. Dwight is very clearly, he is standing outside the Lakers window, holding a boombox above his head. Even with that being the case, though, and the Lakers clearly needing another big, I don't see them cutting Christian Wood and locking that dead money onto their books.
I mean, it's two things. One, I think the dead money thing is 100% a factor. And then two, what about the possibility that the Lakers would just be interested in keeping him next season? Sure. As some additional salary and potential deals, or just as like basically to keep him in the same role he is now as a bench big. Like, I think there are worse things you can do with, you know, one of your last couple roster spots. And so I think that it would be, I just don't think it would be in the Lakers' best interest to cut Christian Wood for the sake of signing someone you might not even use in the playoffs, because you'll have Anthony Davis, you'll have Jackson Hayes. I think you can pencil in AD for about 38 to 40 minutes every single night. And so to me, the front office and the coaching staff, I think, are comfortable with letting the chips fall where they may with the other 8 to 10 center minutes in a game. So,
well, and they're comfortable letting the chips fall where they may. That was the decision they made at the trade deadline as well, that they're going to try to keep their powder dry as much as they can for the summer. And therefore taking dead money under the books would not be in that line of thinking. So I don't see them cutting Christian Wood, period, even if it's to add another big, which I think they do need another big. I think even if Christian Wood picks up his player option, even if Jackson Hayes picks up his player option for next year, they need to go get a physical big this summer. It's clear you can't, it's not going to work to have two guys who are 4/5s in Christian Wood and Jackson Hayes behind Anthony Davis. You need a real, legitimate, true center. You may not need him every night, but for certain matchups you do. The Lakers have been lacking that this season, and I think that's something they need to fix in the offseason. As far as them paying Christian Wood's medical expenses, I'm sure they would. They've placed themselves as a very player-friendly organization. They did it way back in the day with Roni Turioff, if you guys remember that. I don't see there'd be any way they would. There's no way they would say, Christian Wood, you're cut, and now you need arthroscopic knee surgery, and here's the bill. No, they're not doing that. They're not doing that.
No, definitely not.
All right. Don said, with Christian Wood out for the foreseeable future, are there any moves that could bolster us at center? Unfortunately, no. Because they have a full roster spot, or a full roster. The only thing that could happen, Matt, would be maybe Colin Castleton gets healthy, although I've heard he's still not back at this point. They're not like expecting him back any minute now. And I don't even know if he would get minutes. And it begs the question, they picked up Harry Giles. He only gets minutes in the stinkiest of garbage time situations. Like not even, like even if it's a 10-point game and they pull the starters, he's not getting that. It's got to be like a 30-point game to get Harry Giles in right now. So the only real help at center could be maybe a returning Colin Castleton. And even he can't play in the postseason because he's on a two-way contract, and the same is true of Harry Giles.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was just going to say, was that I think some fans will probably throw out this idea of cut one of the two-way guys, sign a center for the playoffs, but unfortunately two-way contract guys aren't eligible for the postseason roster. So Colin Castleton probably would have been the default option if it was legal, but you know, it's just not. So to answer the question, I just don't think there is a move. I think the Lakers have what they have, and they're just going to have to figure it out.
And that's not ideal. That's not what I want to say, right? That's not the best. That's not, they have what they have and they're good. No, they need another big. The problem is there's nobody you can cut without putting dead money on your books for next summer. And clearly they made the choice of the trade deadline that they were prioritizing the summer. And part of that was there weren't good deals out there for them to make. You know, I know a lot of people get frustrated. Oh, I can't believe they didn't get LeBron more help to try to win right now. There were not realistic good deals on the table for the Lakers at the trade deadline, which is why they decided to wait until the summer and see what they can find there. It's going to be a big summer for regardless of how this season finishes up. We could be seeing change in the coaching position. They're going to be in the thick of all the trade rumors for some of the biggest names on the market. We're going to be busy this summer, Matt. Choco Thunder became a channel member. Welcome. And then we'll finish it off with this. Buck said, we get the fifth seed if we run the table. So they would have to go 14-0 to finish the season. I don't know that even that would get it done. Only two games left that we could lose even if we play hard.
You know what, Trevor? This just tells me that we got more optimists in the Lakers.
There's optimism
family.
In the air.
There is. Look, we have to run the table. Yes, that part's true, but we also would require people to lose.
Yes. And so look at, speaking of the table, the Lakers right now, they sit 2.5 games behind the Phoenix Suns. Getting to the fifth seed, there's no way. There's no way. The Lakers are 11 games back. The Pelicans are 5.5 games back. And the Pelicans have been playing really well. They're 8-2 in their last 10.
They're sneaky hot right now.
Yeah. You're not catching them. So you're not getting to the fifth. Even if the Lakers won out, I don't see them getting to the fifth seed. The Kings, even if they won, I don't know that they'd even catch the Kings. And they don't have the tiebreaker over the Kings. I think their best shot, the best thing we could see the Lakers do right now based on the current standings, it would be to move up to the eighth seed. That's the best case scenario right now for the Lakers is they move to eight, which is actually a really big deal because that gets you into double elimination in the seven or the eight seed. If you're 9 or 10, it's single elimination in the play-in tournament. And Phoenix does have a difficult schedule from here on out. And the Lakers do have the tiebreaker over the Suns. So while it's not likely, it's not impossible for the Lakers to catch Phoenix. But that is the best case scenario. I don't see them moving up to seven. I don't see them moving up to six. Certainly not to five. Best case, I think the Lakers move to eight. Worst case is they fall to 10. I think that's where I'm landing right now, Matt.
You know, it just kind of hit me that the standings are a little bit reflective of the new generation of NBA stars and the old guard.
Because Anthony Edwards, SGA, Jokic are at the top, and then you've got Durant, LeBron, AD, Curry in the bottom of the table here in terms of, you know, postseason teams.
Yeah, just a really minor observation, but I was like, oh, the NBA really is cyclical in nature. But yes, I'm in agreement with everything you said. For anyone out there that's wondering, should the Lakers just stay at 9 and 10 or go up to 7 and 8? The answer is always move up and give yourself the best chance to make the postseason outright. I know people are already looking up ahead at matchups, but you have to get there first to get the matchup. So that's where I stand on that. And then, yeah, it sounds like a lot to jump 2.5 games, but the Suns do have the second hardest schedule left in the NBA, and the Lakers are, I think, 19th. So very doable. Like, if anyone's curious, go look at the last 13 games. You look at a lot of those opponents, and you can say things that we haven't really been able to say much. It's like, they should win that game.
Right. they should win that game. Now the Suns, they do have, I think the Suns next four games, like they play the Spurs twice. They've got some easy games there, and then it gets brutal from there. You have to hope, I think, two things. You have to hope in terms of the Suns, you have to hope, number one, that the Suns lose one of their upcoming, I don't care which one it is, but they've got a couple of games against the Spurs. They've got some easier opponents in the next few. They got to drop one of those games. And then you've got to hope that the teams they're playing down the stretch when their schedule is really difficult aren't resting guys, aren't at spots where they're locked in and they say, that's it. Like, let's take a look here. Here's what I'm talking about. Here's the Suns schedule the rest of the way. So they've got Philly without Embiid. They have Atlanta. Now that's second night of a back-to-back. DeJounte Murray, you beat the Clippers. Can you do it again for us and beat the Suns? Then they get two against San Antonio. But then look at this. Oof, oh my gosh. Bro. Denver, OKC, New Orleans, Cleveland, yeah, Minnesota, New Orleans again, Clippers, second night of a back-to-back, Clippers again, Sacramento, Minnesota. Now, are the Clippers locked into the four seed? And you know what? If it would benefit the Lakers for the Suns to lose, I would not put it past the Clippers at all to throw those games.
Oh, 100%.
I could see them doing it. So that's the other fear, is that how many of these teams will be locked into their spot at that point, especially these last four games, and may just rest a bunch of guys? So those last four that look tough could wind up being not so tough. But there's, I mean, Denver, OKC, you need them to lose a bunch of these games in here. Denver, OKC, New Orleans, Cleveland, Minnesota, New Orleans. I mean, like a nice five, maybe six game losing streak. That'd be
one can only hope.
Wouldn't that be great? Obviously, that's not really going to happen. But even if they lose, you know, a few of those, if the Lakers could finish out on a nice run, not impossible for them to move up to that eight seed.
You know, just to wrap this whole thing up, going back to the whole LeBron gas tank thing, I wonder how much the Suns win-loss record plays into how much he'll try.
That's fair. That's true. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know if LeBron looks at the 9-10 and thinks, oh, we can't go to Golden State and win, so we have to be the 9. Wouldn't shock me if the Lakers look at it as though if they have a shot to get up to 8, you gun for it. And if it becomes if there's a point, if the Suns go on like a 5-game win streak or something like that, and it's clear that you're just not getting there, wouldn't shock me if they kind of take their foot off the gas a little bit, rest some of their guys, and then just trust that they can go up to Golden State in a play-in game and win.
That's also assuming Golden State wins out, because as you know, Trevor, they are one game behind the Lakers right now.
They are one game behind. You're right. You're right. And the Lakers do play Golden State again this season. Hopefully they can get the win in that one. And then that would be based on division record. Right now, we'll see how it finishes. But right now, that would get the Lakers the tiebreaker. So something else to keep an eye on.
Yep.
All right, Matt, thank you again for doing this a second time. I do appreciate it. Thanks for coming on here. Somehow we made it through. And everybody out there listening and watching, this is one of the worst feelings in the world. When you do a show and it's gone, it seems to happen like once a season. So hopefully this does not happen again this season for us. But thank you everybody for watching. Thank you everybody for listening. Make sure you subscribe over to the YouTube channel. And Matt, thank you for being gracious and doing a second take of this show.
Trevor. Well, okay. Well, first of all, for anyone that's still listening to the podcast or watching this, little behind the scenes, it's very rare when Trevor texts me in all caps, and I can't even recall another time when it's happened. So I knew something was amiss.
when I sent you the text, that was just dude.
Yeah. It never happens, and you guys must be careful. And look, Trevor is recording this a lot later than I am his time, so guys, if we sound a little loopy or delirious, apologies. But I would just like to echo and say thank you for bearing with us. And you know, if we ever dig up that episode, Trevor, it would be hilarious to upload it one day.
the lost episode,
the lost tape. Yeah.
All right. Well, everybody, thank you again for joining the show. And Matt, thank you. Till next time. See ya and stay safe.